Okay. Good morning, please. Hope you had a great. Hope you had a great night, and welcome to our class again. We'll just continue from where we stopped last time, and I hope you are spending some time to read, to study the things we've done before. We've been a little bit slow. We need to move with the speed of light, and because we've got to complete blood physiology before the end of the month, okay, and we haven't done thrombocytes and leukocytes, so that's a huge thing. So we are finishing red blood cells today. Wherever we end, you round up with it. So on next week, we will most likely have three classes. The first one would try to round off with thrombocytes. The second one, we'll see, we'll have to start leukocytes. Okay, and go far with it. Because we need to forget about blood physiology very soon. And even if we don't have those classes, I'll send the material and you read it. Okay, we've actually delayed a little bit behind. We are actually behind. So today we'll quickly rush. I hope that the notes I sent to you in front of, because there's some things I'll just point out and move on. Okay, we need to finish. And I'm also sure that you've submitted your assignments. It was supposed to be 9:50. So you've done that. So anything after 9:50? Uncle shared some notes. Iron metabolism. I'll talk about it today, but I've given you an additional material to build up your knowledge on. Okay. Last time we started talking about red blood cells, and we went to the point of talking about hemoglobin. We talked about hemoglobin derivatives. And after looking at hemoglobin derivatives, we looked at the various types of hemoglobins, and then we ended with hemoglobin S. And so today we'll be looking at hemoglobin destruction. Okay, we'll be looking at hemoglobin destruction. Now, we said the lifespan of red blood cell is about 100 to 130 days. Okay, and thus a little under 1% of the circulating red cells is destroyed each day and is replaced by reticulocytes from the bone marrow. Okay, so as the red cells are in circulation and they age, of course the metabolic processes that maintain is in the cellular is the integrity of the cell membrane and structure, the ones we discussed before, they are becoming weak, and so the cells become smaller and more dense, and there is a decline in the activity of glycolytic enzymes and other enzymes. Okay, so these cells become fragile. They become fragile, and they are removed from the circulation by the reticuloendothelial system, or when they are removed from the circulation by macrophages in the bone marrow, the spleen, and the liver. Okay, so when these red blood cells become old, they become fragile, it's weak, it's poor. They are mopped up from the blood from circulation by what? By macrophages, which are present in the bone marrow, the spleen, and the liver. And these collectively with others form what we call reticuloendothelial system. We'll look at when we come to white blood cells. Okay, so we need the macrophages. What happens? The hemoglobin is broken down to the heme and to the globin. Okay, the hemoglobin is broken down to what? To the heme and the globin portion. Okay, what is the globin? It's just polypeptide, isn't it? So this polypeptide is further broken down to what? To constituent amino acids, which are stored in what we call the amino acid pool. Okay, what we call the amino acid pool. And so this amino acid is used in further resynthesis of more hemoglobin. What the iron joined to the porphyrin group, isn't it? So the heme is further broken down to what? Iron and what? And a porphyrin called bilirubin. okay, and it's done by the enzyme heme oxygenase. Okay, so this heme is broken down to what? To iron, and to the porphyrin component is to bilirubin. Okay, and it's a long, there are in between steps. Okay, but it forms what are called bilirubin, and this is by the enzyme heme oxygenase. Okay, so this iron can be is released into the blood. And it's transported as transferrin. It's transported by the transport protein called transferrin, or the iron can be stored as what? Ferritin, to be used in the further production of what? Heme. Okay, so the iron is stored as ferritin, or transported in blood by transferrin and stored. Okay. The bilirubin is further reduced to what? To bilirubin. Okay, it's further reduced to what? To bilirubin. Okay, now this bilirubin is now released into the plasma. Okay, the bilirubin released into the plasma combines with a plasma protein called what? Albumin. Okay, combined with the plasma protein, it's carried by a plasma protein called what? Albumin. Even though it is combined to albumin, called what? Free bilirubin. It's called what? Free bilirubin or unconjugated bilirubin. It's called what? Free bilirubin or unconjugated bilirubin. Okay, so conjugated bilirubin is moving. It's picked up by the liver. Okay, it's picked up by the liver. Okay, so the bilirubin now detaches from the albumin and is transported into the hepatocyte. Okay, so material says this transport is facilitated. Okay, it's conjugated. By conjugated, that means what? A certain moiety, certain functional group added to it. Okay, so certain substances are added to the bilirubin. One of them is glucuronic acid. Okay, glucuronic acid. About 80% of the bilirubin is glucuronated. Okay, it's glucuronated. Okay, so glucuronic acid is added to the bilirubin. Okay. Okay, and then it can also be conjugated to what? Sulfates. So this, when glucuronic acid is added to this bilirubin, it is called what? Conjugated bilirubin. Okay, it is called what? Conjugated bilirubin. Okay, so within the hepatocytes, this conjugation takes place. Okay, and then remember that one of the functions of the hepatocyte is a secretion of what? Bile pigments. Okay, so bilirubin is a bile pigment. Okay, it's a bile pigment. This is the one, the one of the functions of the hepatocyte, excretion of bile pigments. So bilirubin is what? A bile pigment. And so this bilirubin is shed into smaller ducts called biliary canaliculi. Biliary canaliculi. Okay, this biliary canaliculi coalesce to give us a call the hepatic ducts. Okay, so you have the right hepatic duct and you have the left hepatic duct. The right hepatic duct drains the right side, the right lobe, while the left hepatic duct drains the left lobe. And these two lobes combine to give us what? The common hepatic duct. Okay, the common hepatic duct. Okay, and so the common hepatic duct drains or secretions or excretory material, or secretory material from the liver. Okay, the common hepatic duct, and then this common hepatic duct combines with the duct that is from the gallbladder. Okay, the duct from the gallbladder is called a cystic duct. Okay, so the combination of the common hepatic duct and the cystic duct gives us what's called the common bile duct. Okay, the common bile duct, and so this common bile duct empties into the small intestines, and into the small intestines through the duodenum. Okay, through the duodenum, forming what we call, and it joins with the common pancreatic duct to give what, to empty at the what called the ampulla of Werther. Okay, and this ampulla of Werther is covered. Okay, the opening is regulated by a sphincter called the sphincter of Oddi. Okay, the sphincter of Oddi. Think of only, okay. So please, you could listen to the video later on and find out so that we move a little bit. Yeah. So this bile pigment, this bilirubin, is emptied into the small intestines, okay. And in the small intestine, hurted by action of bacteria to form what we call urobilin gene. Okay, urobilino gene. Okay, this urobilino gene, a portion of it, several of it is reabsorbed through what we call the enterohepatic circulation. It's reabsorbed into the general circulation through the what we call the enterohepatic circulation. And then as the blood is moving through the and excreted as urobilin, okay, when it's oxidized, when it comes in contact with oxygen, it is oxidized into urobilin, and this is what gives the urine its golden color. Then in the large intestines, it is excreted in feces, okay? And when it is oxidized, form what's called starcobilinogen or starcobilin, okay, starcobilin. Okay, so the first assignment, which I would want you to do, not the first assignment, but then for this discussion, is just draw the diagram of the hepatobiliary tree. Draw the diagram of the hepato. Biliary tree. So what you do, you draw it, and you can take a picture of it, and then you crop it and put it in a Word document and convert it to a PDF, okay, with other things. So it's drawn, you draw it with your hands, okay? You draw it with your hands. So call it the hepatobiliary tree. Okay, so you draw a short note on the enterohepatic circulation. Okay, hepatobiliary tree, and then the intestine and the liver. Okay, and the importance of the enterohepatic circulation. What is the relevance of it? Okay. All that is 10 marks, okay? No, 15 marks. Okay, the diagram is 5. The description of the enterohepatic circulation is 5 marks, and the significance or the relevance of this enterohepatic circulation. And it's up, yeah. This what is it's another 5 marks. Okay, so that's quite important. So please, I don't want anybody to send me a downloaded version of the hepatobiliary tree, please. It's hand drawn, okay? So when we started the course, we had talked about the site of formation of red cells, which I told you about the embryonic stage, the extramedullary stage and the medullary stages. Okay, so and so, what are the factors that will affect red cell count? They are quite elucidated on your PowerPoint. Okay, so what you would do, you would read the PowerPoint I gave you, read at erythrocyte sedimentation rate, factors that affect it, and then the osmotic fragility. Okay, and, okay. Or osmotic fragility, which is a tendency for a red blood cell to resist hemolysis, when the tendency for the red cell to resist hemolysis when placed in a hypotonic solution. Hemolysis, red cell crenation in a hypotonic. Place a red cell in different concentrations of solutions or different concentration of saline solution, and then you look at, you determine the time it takes for it to work to lyse, okay? And then you can be able to. So the factors that affect receptor fragility are elucidated there. And then what are the causes? So we can focus on the causes of hemolysis and dangers of hemolysis, okay? So let's focus on the causes of hemolysis and the dangers of hemolysis. So people are asking, when is the assignment due? At the end of the class, please remind me. There are still other ones that I comment. Just short, okay? So we are looking at the causes of hemolysis. We are talking about hemolysis, lysis of the red cell, isn't it? Okay, it's lysis of the red cell. So for one of the causes is that if you inject a hypotonic intravenous injection of excess amounts of hypotonic solution, what happens? The red cells would pick up a lot of blood, a lot of fluid, sorry, and they would lyse, isn't it? So another thing, if you have mismatched blood transfusion, incompatible blood transfusion, we'll look at that when we come to hemostasis, when we come to erythrocytes. When you do a blood transfusion and then there is agglutination, okay, there is incompatible blood groups, so this will lead to agglutination and what? Breakage and lysis of red cells, which is antibody antigen reaction, so to speak. Okay, then the next thing is deficiency of glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme. Okay, this is an enzyme that is in, this is an important enzyme in the pentose phosphate pathway, and the activity of this enzyme is important in the maintenance of the integrity of the red cell membrane. Okay, the glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme is important in the, it's a key enzyme in the pentose phosphate pathway, whose deficiency will mean that the NADPH, okay, that's supposed to be formed, and other products that are required for the maintenance of the integrity of the red cell will be deficient. So the red cell membrane will be fragile. And another thing, snake venom. Okay, snake venom, some chemicals like arsenic or bacteria toxins can also cause red cell lysis. Okay, that's one of the things, probably maybe when someone is bitten by a snake, the person has a systemic, not just sepsis or what we call intravascular blood clotting. There is also lysis of red blood cells. Okay. And we also have hereditary spherocytosis, where the red cells are spherical due to a deficiency in the proteins we mentioned that are involved in the cytoskeleton. Okay, And then we also have thalassemias as well as sickle cell hemoglobin. Okay. Leukie, is it Leukie? I don't know by the third cause after agglutination. Is it deficiency of the glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme? Yeah, so I mentioned that as a key enzyme involved in the pentose phosphate pathway. Okay, and its deficiency would mean that there will be some proteins or some substances will be absent. For example, we mentioned the NADPH. Okay. And that are relevant and important in the maintenance of the integrity of the red cell membrane. So when this enzyme is absent or deficient, these substances are absent, so the red cell membrane will be fragile. So we mentioned venous injection, hereditary spherocytosis, blood freezing, okay, formed ice crystals can cause disruption of the red cells. And then another thing is fat solvents. Red cells, of course, remember we mentioned that what their membrane is a lipid bilayer, so fat solvents can be able to destroy the lipoprotein. Okay, so when we have hemolysis, what are the consequences, what are the effects or dangers of hemolysis? Remember, you are breaking down, you are lysing red cells. Okay, so one of the things that if there is lysis of red cell means what? You bring out the hemoglobin, isn't it? Okay, and so there could be a level of the first thing you have jaundice. Okay, jaundice, because when you lyse the red blood cell, just as you've broken the red blood cell, the hemoglobin will break down. Okay, and when hemoglobin is broken down, you will give what? Bilirubin. Okay, so what is jaundice? Jaundice is the could be physiological or pathological condition in which the bilirubin levels are excess. I think they are greater than 2 milligrams per deciliter of blood. Okay, that's where the concentration of hemoglobin of bilirubin is greater than 2 milligrams per deciliter of blood, and it's accompanied by yellowish coloration of the the skin, the sclera, and the mucous membranes. Okay. There's a yellowish discoloration of the skin, the sclera, and the mucous membrane as a result of what? Hyperbilirubinemia. Okay, that's the first thing. Then secondly, there will be increased plasma colloid osmotic pressure. There will be increased plasma colloid osmotic pressure because in that lysis, you release so many solutes into the plasma, increasing its osmotic potential. Okay, and this can prevent tissue fluid formation. Okay, yeah, it can prevent tissue fluid formation. Can we still remember when we described tissue fluid formation? Okay, then you can also have hemoglobinuria. Okay, where you there will be excretion of hemoglobin in urine. Okay, there will be excretion of hemoglobin in urine, and this hemoglobin can be precipitated in the renal tubules, leading to what called oliguria, scanty urine. Okay, oliguria, scanty urine. Okay, so if we have precipitation of hemoglobin, it can give us some what called renal stones and predispose to kidney failure. Okay, then the next thing is hemodilution. Okay, the hemoglobin will be diluted. Okay, there will be hemodilution by the plasma, and this will shift the oxygen hemoglobin decision curve to the left. Okay, to the left. Now we'll discuss that in respiration detailing, the association of hemoglobin and oxygen. Okay, so when there's a shifting of hemoglobin decision curve to the left, it leads to less oxygen being delivered to the tissues. That means the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen is too much. It's tight. The oxygen is tightly bound to hemoglobin and it cannot be released. Okay. Then next we'll have tissue hypoxia, because due to even this fact that oxygen is not released, definitely the oxygen levels at the tissues will be low. So we'll have our tissue hypoxia due to hemoglobin loss and due to hemoglobin dilution. Okay, then we could also have acidosis. Okay, acidosis of hemoglobin leading to kidney stones and renal stones. Okay, now so the excretion of what? Of hydrogen ion. So hydrogen ion will be accumulated in the blood, giving us what? Acidosis. Okay, and due to the decrease in the buffering mechanism or the buffering effect of hemoglobin, there's a possibility this can also what? Acidosis. Why? Because remember we mentioned that hemoglobin combines with hydrogen ion to give us what? Hemoglobinic acid. Okay, and also oxyhemoglobin is acidic. Okay, it's slightly acidic. So because of the fact that oxygen is not delivered, it's not released from the hemoglobin, we have a concentration of oxyhemoglobin is high, and what leading to what? An increase in the level of what? Acidity. Vasodilation, systemic vasodilation. Okay, systemic vasodilation, and for example, something like histamine would decrease. Okay, the blood volume would drop because when there's systemic vasodilation, the capacity of the blood vessels increases, but the blood volume seems to be small for it. Okay, then you have hyperkalemia. Remember, one of the when there is a rupture of the red cells, there will be release of potassium into the plasma, leading to what? Hyperkalemia. Okay, Lucas, you can go after that after the class, and then you play the video again. Okay, we've been held down behind for quite a while, so if I don't do that, we'll suffer in the other aspects, and I'll have to give you to study them, which I don't want to. Okay, so we have looked at the dangers of the effects of hemolysis. So let's look at erythropoiesis. Okay, it's an important topic, erythropoiesis. So what is erythropoiesis? The process of the production of what? Red cells, isn't it? Okay, and it goes through several stages. Okay, if you look at the bone marrow, the first recognizable red cell precursor is what we call the proerythroblast. Okay, is the proerythroblast. Okay, so we have the proerythroblast, which is basophilic. Okay, it's the basophilic cytoplasm reflecting the content of the RNA and ribosomal. Okay, so we have the proerythroblast. Okay, and then it undergoes several stages. Okay, from the proerythroblast to the erythroblast, from the erythroblast, it goes to the reticulocyte, from the reticulocyte now it matures to erythrocytes. But given all this process, one of the first things that there are changes that occur. First, there is a gradual reduction in the size of the red cell. Okay, now there is gradual reduction of the size from the megaloblast, from the reduction in the size of the nucleus. Okay, there's gradual reduction in the size of the nucleus and the eventual disappearance. We call it pycnosis. Okay, nuclear pycnosis. Okay, there is gradual reduction in the size and this and eventual disappearance of the nucleus. Okay, the staining. So then another thing is there is also gradual hemoglobination. Okay, because the pro-erythroblast doesn't have hemoglobin, and so there's gradual synthesis of hemoglobin. So we have gradual hemoglobination. Okay, there's gradual hemoglobination. Okay. Other details you can find out from the PowerPoint I shared with you. So if you're following this particular lecture, and probably maybe you are not part of my students, you could pick up the PowerPoint from my website and then you can follow keenly. Okay. So we want to look at factors that affect erythrocytes. Okay, what factors that affect erythropoiesis? Okay, there are many things I'm trying to skip out. They are covered in my PowerPoint. And so factors that affect erythropoiesis. One of the key factors is blood oxygen tension. Okay, blood oxygen tension. Erythropoiesis is stimulated when the blood oxygen tension is decreased, for example, in high altitudes and after hemorrhage. Okay, and so and so. So and then oxygen lack is the most powerful stimulus for erythropoiesis. Okay, oxygen lack is the most powerful stimulus. Oxygen lack is the most powerful stimulus for what? For inducing secretion of a hormone, and it induces the secretion of a hormone called erythropoietin from the kidneys. Okay, and so please, the students who haven't joined the class, I'm only seeing more than 31 students, and it would be funny enough to think they are struggling to submit an assignment, which I could choose to consider it zero. You're supposed to have submitted it by 9:50. I'm still having just 130 students, okay, and that is not good enough. And so you can still miss the class and miss the assignment. So what are you better again on one side, okay? So we have the blood oxygen tension, okay? If it's dropped, yeah, when there's hypoxia, it stimulates the production of what? Erythropoietin from the kidneys, okay? So what is erythropoietin? It's a glycoprotein. What does it do? It affects all the stages. It increases the number, it increases the red cell formation by stimulating the bone marrow, okay? And the release of erythropoietin is stimulated by oxygen lack, and by the male sex hormone androgen, or by this male sex hormone testosterone, okay, which is an androgen, okay. So erythropoietin production is stimulated by what? By hypoxia. Erythropoietin production is stimulated by what? By oxygen lack, and by the male sex hormone what? Testosterone, okay. And also cobalt salts, also and then this production is facilitated by catecholamines and in conditions of non-alkalosis. Okay. Now 10 to 15% of erythropoietin is also produced from the liver. Okay, it's also produced from the liver and secreted by the hepatic cells of the Kupffer and the Kupffer cells of the liver. Remember when I told you about Kupffer cells? Yes, okay. So they are also produced by the hepatocytes and the Kupffer cells of the liver. Okay, and so erythropoietin is needed in all stages of erythropoiesis. It increases the rate of mitosis of red cell precursor. They see a possibility of erythropoiesis being maintained in people who have chronic renal failure. Okay, why? Because 10 to 15% of erythropoietin is produced from where? From the liver. Okay, and so we also have erythropoietin being produced by recombinant DNA techniques. Okay, by recombinant DNA techniques. So, and it's now available to treat intractable anemia, which occurs for individuals who have chronic renal failure. Okay, so we have recombinant DNA production, okay? As I've mentioned, we also have factors that will stimulate erythropoiesis, the androgens. Okay, could this suggest why probably maybe Males have more red cells than females. And then we also this we have it is also we say stimulated by androgens, by corticosteroids, by growth hormone, by thyroxine, which act by what? Stimulating bone marrow. They act by stimulating the release of what? Growth factors in the bone marrow. Then we also have the liver, the role of the liver. The liver forms part of hemoglobin. I mean, it forms the globin part of hemoglobin. It also stores vitamin and several minerals that are required for red cell formation, especially iron. And then we have diet. You need to eat well to have your adequate red cells formed. Proteins of high biological value, iron synthesis, iron required for synthesis of heme and cobalt and copper. And you have vitamins B12, folic acid, iron. And so that those are the factors that those are the requirements, the things we need for erythropoiesis. And I want to stress a little bit more on iron metabolism. So one is what I want you to understand keenly. And so I've shared a material with the class reps. It should circulate. Can you go to that diagram there? So if the fundamentals of iron metabolism are there, which of course we mentioned iron is an essential element and it's a component of myoglobin, of enzymes like cytochrome oxidase, and the body contains about 2 to 5 grams of iron, and 60% to 70% of it is present in what? In hemoglobin. 4 to 5% in myoglobin and others in enzymes and what? Ferritin. And the daily requirement for iron must be equal to the amount of that which is lost. And that daily requires about 0.6 milligrams in males and 1.2 milligrams in females. Why? Because we know that females lose blood during menstruation, so they need to constantly replenish, due to what? Pregnancy, iron deficiency, and what? Severe infections. Severe infections. From plus 3 duodenum, and only in the fetal state. And it's this is done by an active process. And so its absorption increases the iron stores in the body. And there are certain factors that will affect iron absorption. There are certain factors that affect iron absorption. The first is gastric hydrochloric acid. Gastric hydrochloric acid. As I mentioned, the iron in the diet is mostly in the plus 3 state, so it has to be converted to the plus 2 state. And the hydrochloric acid dissolves the iron, permits it to form soluble complexes with substances that aids its reduction. And one of those substances is vitamin C. And iron in inorganic compounds are more readily absorbed than iron in organic compounds. And there's the role of the intestinal mucosa cell is very important. It's very important. So most of the iron in the diet, as I mentioned, is in the plus 3 state. So look at the diagram which you have, on your PowerPoint, and it is converted, it's first converted to the plus 2 state by the ferric reductase enzyme. And this ferric reductase enzyme is at the brush border, at the brush borders of the erythrocyte. So this iron in the plus 3 state is converted to iron in the plus 2 state, and by the ferric reductase enzyme. And it is transported into the cells by the apical membrane called the divalent metal transporter 1, DMT1. It's called as DMT1, means divalent metal transporter 1. So the ferric ion is converted to ferrous ion by the ferric reductase enzyme, and this ion is now transported by the divalent metal transporter 1. But we have heme ion. This heme ion is in the plus 2 state. So the heme is transported into the cells, by the heme transporter, or what we call the heme carrier proteins, HCP. So some books call it the heme transporter or the heme carrier protein. Then the inside the cell, the heme, the iron from the iron in the plus two state is released from the heme by the enzyme heme oxygenase. Okay, and this ion is now added to what? This ion is now added to the intracellular iron pool. Okay, so this ion. Now remember, we have the non-heme ion and the heme ion. Okay, we have iron in the heme, and we have non-heme ion, which is the plus three state, which is reduced to plus two state by the ferroreductase enzyme, and the plus two ion now is taken into the enterocytes by the heme carrier protein. Okay, by the heme carrier protein. Okay, and then so we have heme, which is in the lumen and is transported into the enterocyte by the heme carrier protein. Okay, by the heme carrier protein, and this heme carrier protein transports heme into the cells, and in the cells, iron in the plus two state is released from the heme by the heme oxygenase enzyme, and the iron is stored in the iron pool of ferritin. Okay. In the non-heme ion, the iron in the plus three state, it is converted in the plus two state by it is converted by the ferroreductase and then carried inside the cell by the divalent metal transporter one. Please, I mix it up by the divalent metal transporter one. Okay. And there inside, the ion is transported from the cells to the basolateral portion, yet by still another transporter. But before the ion is transported, the first thing is that the intracellular ion, which is in the plus two state, is first converted to the plus three state, combines with apoferritin to form ferritin and is stored. Okay. Please make sure you are with your PowerPoint so that you're following the diagram. Then the ion, the remaining ion which is in the cell, is transported into the interstitial fluid at the basolateral borders of the enterocytes by the transporter called ferroportin 1. Okay, and such a transporter is helped by another protein called hefestin. Okay, called hefestin. Okay, and so in the blood, the iron in the plus 2 state is converted to plus 3. And then, which is bound to the, remember we mentioned, okay, and it can be stored in the liver as what, ferritin, or what, as what, hemosiderin. Okay. Okay, so that's what you have it in that diagram. And so make sure you look at that diagram, please. So let's look at causes of negative ion balance, okay? The causes of negative ion balance. We have three causes of ion negative. We could be either increased physiological demands, what will make us to have a negative ion balance. That means the amount of ion we lose is much more than the amount of ion we take. Okay, so input doesn't match output. Okay, so there's a deficit, just as we had it with water balance, right? Okay, so what are the causes? So we would have increased physiological, there are three, I gave you three, increased physiological demands, inadequate absorption, and blood loss. Okay, so we have increased physiological demand, inadequate absorption, and what? Loss of blood. Okay, so for increased physiological demands, this could occur during periods of rapid growth, especially in young children, right? We could also have when there is a need for extra iron in pregnancy and for menstruation. So this makes women liable. So increased physiological demands in periods of rapid growth, especially in infants, during pregnancy when there's an increased demand, and what, during what, menstruation. So we could also have cause of negative ion balance, or which about inadequate absorption. Inadequate absorption. For example, when we have after surgery, after gastrectomy, when there's a removal of portions of the stomach. Okay, we'll see how, because the stomach produces, some cells produce what we call intrinsic factor. Okay, or sorry, this the in relation to iron, they produce hydrochloric acid. The produce hydrochloric acid, which we have mentioned before, is important in the process of reducing iron 3 to iron 2. Okay, So we have place of gastrectomy, and then if you have in areas of inadequate absorption, okay, inadequate absorption, in instance of inadequate absorption, isn't it? Malabsorption. So we'll be having poor absorption of iron. We say iron is absorbed in the duodenum, okay? And then we could also have low dietary intake in adults may contribute to iron deficiency, okay? For example, during pregnancy and during infancy. Okay, for example, during chronic bleeding, could be people who have PI, people who have gastric ulcers. Okay, so could have that. Okay, or even during menstruation. Okay, cobalamin. Okay, cobalamin, it is going to contain, this is a cobalt containing vitamin. Excuse me. And they are required for menses. Excuse me, please. So, if in the absence there is failure of what nuclear maturation, there's failure of nuclear maturation, okay? And vitamin B12 promotes growth, stimulates other hematopoietic processes in the bone marrow, and it's essential for the formation of myelin sheath or myelin in the nervous tissue. Okay? If you look at what I've given you there, you would see the absorption of vitamin B12, okay, which of course in the distal part of the ileum, okay, by absorption of vitamin B12, of course, in the distal part of the ileum and requires what we call intrinsic factor, okay. So sometimes the vitamin B12 is called the extrinsic factor, and the intrinsic factor is produced from the parietal cells of the stomach, of the GIT, which is in the stomach. So this intrinsic factor combines with vitamin B12 to form a complex that is absorbed in the terminal ileum. We take note of that. Okay, and so this complex binds to special receptors in the distal ileum called cubilin. Okay, cubilin. Okay, and this causes the absorption of the complex by endocytosis. Okay, so within the ileal enterocyte, the vitamin B12 is released and then transferred by a special protein called transcobalamin 2. So this transcobalamin 2 transports vitamin B12 from the ileal enterocyte into the interstitial space, which is absorbed into the plasma. Okay. And large amounts of vitamin B12 are stored in the liver, from which it can be released into the bone marrow for erythropoiesis. Okay. So, what could cause the deficiency of vitamin B12? We have lack of the gastric intrinsic factor. Okay. Could be, and what will happen for us to lack this intrinsic factor, maybe you have an autoimmune disease in which there is a destruction of the parietal cells, or total gastrectomy where the whole of the stomach is removed, certain disease of the distal ileum, okay, in which there is malabsorption, okay, or you have situation in which there is congenital deficiency of this of special receptors, okay, in the what in the distal ileum, okay. Vitamin B12 deficiency, it is actually maybe the deficiency or an issue with what intrinsic factor. Okay, intrinsic factor. Lack of vitamin B12 is very okay. Even if you are absent of it, the liver can store vitamin B12. I don't think it's probably 6 months or 12 months. Yeah, and so vitamin B12 will lead to what? Pernicious anemia. Okay, and it's mostly due to what? Absent factor. Okay. So folic acid are important in what? Nuclear maturation. So in this situation, the red cells are they are nucleated, they are larger than mature red cells, and so their lifespan is short because they become fragile. Okay, their lifespan is short. So we have megaloblastic anemia. So we also have it's characterized by leukopenia and thrombocytopenia. Leukopenia, we mentioned decrease in leukocytes and thrombocytopenia. It's a decrease in what thrombocytes. Okay. And one of the another main manifestation is that what we have neurological symptoms. Remember, I mentioned it's important in what growth of the nerve tissue and also what myelination is it. Okay. So this when there's vitamin B12, it leads to what degeneration of the dorsal and the lateral columns of the spinal cord. You think of the dorsal, yeah. You may not be able to feel sensations. And the lateral columns, we get from the lateral columns what arises? The autonomic fibers arise. Okay, so one of the ways to treat pernicious anemia is to administer what, vitamin B12 by injection. Why don't we, in case of pernicious anemia, we have vitamin B12 tablets. Why don't we take them? Please, I need the answer quick. You've read it. Somebody saying network is playing hide and seek. Okay, that could be true. It's also not the best here. So let's quickly look at anemias. Okay, anemias. Okay, so we have the functional definition of anemia is a disorder in which what? A decrease in the amount of circulating hemoglobin reduces the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, so that there is insufficient oxygen to meet the needs of the tissue. This is a functional definition of anemia. Okay, a disorder in which a decrease in the amount of circulating hemoglobin reduces the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood. For clinical purposes, we define anemia on an arbitrary basis of the concentration of circulating hemoglobin. Okay, on the concentration of circulating hemoglobin. Thus, anemia is a reduction in the concentration of hemoglobin in the blood below the lower limit of the normal range of the age and sex of the patient. Okay, and the question I was asking, the question is, in treatment of pernicious anemia, even though we have vitamin B12 tablets or capsules, why don't we give them, why do we give injection of vitamin B12? Okay, so I'm saying that for clinical purposes, our definition is on the basis of what? A reduction of the concentration of hemoglobin concentration below the lower limits of the normal range for the age and the sex. So you must take in consideration of what? The age and the sex. Age and the sex. So who is he talking about? The complex. When I finished the complex like 3 days ago. So the normal range of hemoglobin, of the average hemoglobin concentration for is about 12 for females, and the lower limit is 14 for males, and around 11 for infants. So when on textbook values, okay, that's one of the things we talk about, okay, based on age and sex. And so also, but then this, even these definitions we have given, they are limited, okay? So, but then, so we should also be thinking geographical. For example, I often say that if you had gone to Kenya and people who are on their high mountain, their hemoglobin concentration is quite high because their red blood cell count is high. And so you would tend to see that the hemoglobin concentration normally is probably maybe 16, 17, 18. And so if an individual there has a red blood cell and hemoglobin concentration of about 14, we should be thinking that could be some level of anemia, isn't it? Okay. While in other areas, their normal range could be even from 10 and above, and you see somebody having a hemoglobin concentration of 9 functional, okay, and nothing is disturbing. So it's also good for us to contextualize our definitions, okay? And one of the things that will bring about anemia is either a decreased rate of production or a decrease or an increased rate of destruction of red blood cells. Decreased rate of production or increase what? Destruction of red blood cells. Okay. And it may be classified in the form of hemorrhagic anemia. This is anemia due to what? Acute or chronic blood loss. Okay. You have individuals who have like peptic ulcers or pile. Or they have what? Is this schistosomiasis or bilharziasis? Okay. Then you have hemolytic anemia, whatever will cause breakdown of red blood cells. Okay. And this hemolytic anemia could be intracapsular causes or congenital causes. You have what? Acquired causes. For congenital causes, just think about it. Okay, Moses has given the right answer for the question I asked. Okay, so you have for congenital causes, we have you begin to think of deficiency of those cytoskeletal proteins, which can lead to congenital spherocytosis, congenital ellipsocytosis. If you have deficiency of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, okay, you could also have sickle cell anemia. Those are inherited, these are inherited congenital things that that could predispose to hemolysis. Okay, so what are the ones that are acquired? Certain drugs. We mentioned even about sulfonamides, right? Chemicals. Even I think tetracycline. I don't know if tetracycline predispose to rupture of that. Okay, but I know sulfonamides. Okay, or sulfanilamides. You have tetracycline. Please confirm that for me. And then you have certain infections like malaria. Of course, we can malaria will lead to destruction of red cells, hypersplenism, which will lead to destruction of red blood cells. You also have compatible blood transfusions, autoimmunity, and the rest. Okay, damage of the bone marrow. So what will bring us a damage in the bone marrow? For example, X-ray radiations. Okay, X-ray radiations, exposure to excess X-ray or gamma radiations. Certain drugs like chloramphenicol, chemicals like arsenic. Okay, you have in case of leukemia, where there's excessive proliferation of white cells, and this would also what lead to a decrease in the production of red cells. And then you have also chronic infections. Then last but not the least, also for this, okay, we have nutritional deficiencies. Okay, for example, if you have iron deficiency, you have iron deficiency anemia. If you have vitamin B12 deficiency, you have pernicious anemia. If you have folic acid deficiency, you have what? Macrocytic anemia. Okay, macrocytic anemia, that means what? The cells are having the red cells are what, large in size. Okay. We could also define anemia or classify anemia on the basis of the red cell size and hemoglobin concentration. This is what you encounter in the hospital, even when you do a hematological analysis, and you would have some of these indices and conclusions. Okay, so look at, so you have according to red cell size and hemoglobin concentration. So according to that, we can have normochromic normocytic anemia. Normochromic, that means where you have the normal hemoglobin concentration and the size of the cell is normal. Okay, the size of the red cells and the hemoglobin content are normal, but their count is low, is lower than normal. That means the red cell count is low, but the content and the size are okay. So you can think of the various, the hemorrhagic, the aplastic, the and you could have cause of chronic renal failure or what, hepatorenal diseases. Okay, what could bring about anemia and hepatorenal disease when there's excessive breakdown of red blood cells, isn't it? Okay. And then let's look at hypochromic microcytic anemia. Hypochromic means what? The hemoglobin content is low and the cell size is what? Low. Okay? And the cell size is low. It's smaller, sorry, the cell size is smaller. So you have iron deficiency anemia, you have thalassemia, you have deficiencies in the synthesis of porphyrin and heme, you have hypothyroidism. Okay. And then macrocytic anemia, that means the cells is large. But then you cannot have a situation, hardly have I heard of that, where you have macrochromic, or is it where you have hyperchromic, sorry, we have hyperchromic cells, where that means the concentration of the hemoglobin is high, is much. I haven't found one. So you have macrocytic normochromic anemia. That means the content is okay. The content of the hemoglobin concentration is okay, but what, the size of the cell is large. And here we have megaloblastic anemia, and in case of what, non-megaloblastic anemia. Okay. And so, what are the effects of anemia? Okay. Think of it. So, the first thing is that we have a reduction in blood viscosity. Okay. And this, when you have a reduction in blood viscosity, this would means there's a decrease in peripheral resistance. And when there's a decrease in peripheral resistance, there will be what? An increased venous return. And consequently, an increase in the cardiac output. Okay? And when there is an increase in the venous return and an increase in cardiac output, what, that means the work of the heart. You have increased what? workload of the heart. Then you could also have oxygen lack due to anemia, and this oxygen lack can lead to what, vasodilation. Okay, will lead to vasodilation, and this will increase return and consequently the cardiac output. And then also you have increased blood velocity, since the rate of flow rate and the viscosity is decreased, the flow rate increases. And so if there is a decrease in viscosity and an increase in velocity, means what, there'll be turbulence, there'll be blood turbulence. Okay. And when there's blood turbulence, it can lead to it can accentuate or augment or increase the heart sounds and murmurs. Okay. Murmurs are abnormal heart sounds, right? We'll look at that. I'm sure I'll be the one to teach you cardiovascular, hopefully. So look at cardiac murmurs. So yeah. Then you also have decreased oxygen content in the arterial blood, and this can always lead to fatigue. Okay. So we have three key things. We have reduction in blood viscosity and oxygen lack. We also have increase in blood velocity, and we have what, decreased oxygen content. So the last assignment, which I'm supposed to give for this class, is discuss the compensatory adjustments to anemia. Discuss the compensatory adjustments to anemia. Okay, so Mutipa, after the class, collect the assignments I've given you, send to me as a text, let me see, and then I share it out, okay? This one is also 15 marks. Take your time in it, don't copy and paste, I will know. You copy and paste, I just strike it off, and you have a zero, okay? Discuss the compensatory adjustments to anemia. Okay. The physiological compensatory adjustments to anemia. Okay. The last things which are on the PowerPoint I give are the blood indices. Okay. The color index, the mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration, the mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration, the mean corpuscular hemoglobin, the mean corpuscular volume. Okay. Then that means the last question is, what are the clinical applications of blood indices? Okay, what are the clinical applications of blood indices? Okay, what are the clinical applications of blood indices? What are the clinical applications of blood indices? So you state a blood index, a one sentence about it, and its clinical application. Please, not long stories. You state the blood index. You define the blood index. What is its range? And what is its clinical application? Okay. So this, how many indices are there? They are in your notes. This is not something you have to just read for further application. One, two, yeah. Four, okay, and then you find out others, okay? So 15 marks as well, okay? 15 marks as well, okay? So far, so good. We'll end the class here. It was a rush hour class, okay? It was a rush hour class, but then I had to do it that way so that we catch up. We need to as soon as possible. Okay, so please, before Monday, before Tuesday, the next class, make sure you have started hemostasis. Okay. That one, I'll just be singing it. I won't be talking about it, I'll be singing it. That's an interesting topic. Okay. So today is Friday. The due date for submission of this assignment is next Saturday. Patience, don't worry, the classwork will collect the assignments and send to me, then I'll be able to do it. I can remember. Okay. I didn't say I'll repeat the first question, so I'll repeat when the assignment will be submitted. So what was the, so can somebody remind us of the first assignment? What was the first assignment? Pardon?
The
No, I mean the first assignment for this class today.
tree.
Okay, yes, the hepatobiliary tree, that you draw the hepatobiliary tree, then you also write on the enterohepatic circulation, and then the clinical relevance or the relevance of the enterohepatic circulation. So those were three questions in one. Okay, each of them is 5 months, and you draw with your hand. Don't download something for me. Draw with your hand, take a snapshot, and then crop it and paste it on a Word document. Assignments, submit them as Word, don't submit them as PDF, right? Yes, submit them as Word, not PDF. So there's a possibility that I could make comments and I don't know, send them back to you. Okay. What has Monday or Tuesday done, Louis? Okay. So study hemostasis before the class next week. We'll have three classes next week. I don't know what days, but we'll have three classes next week. Okay. Okay, thank you so much, please. And make sure you have submitted your assignment for today. Okay. Long day.